but a wonderful welcome. And I think I can do no better than give you a wonderful greeting too, that you would hear if you came with me to Gombe National Park, climb up the hills in the morning, and if you're lucky, you hear the chimpanzees. And that simply means, this is me, this is Jane. Every chimpanzee has his or her own individual, it's called a pantoot, and so you can recognize who is calling, and that's how they maintain contact within a community where individuals may travel about alone, sometimes in small mixed groups, sometimes the mother with her family, sometimes many gathering together when a new fruit becomes ripe. And so those calls, that particular call, is a very important one, enabling the individuals to keep in touch with each other. Well, I want to go back to the beginning, and I know many of you know my story, but I'm going back to the beginning simply to try and explain how it is that this little girl born to a family with very little money in England just before World War II, how it is that I'm doing what I'm doing today, how it is that I've done what I've done. And so I have to go back to, first of all, saying that this extraordinary journey that I've been on during my 84 years of life on planet Earth has only been made possible because of the amazing people who've helped me along the way, like the staff of the Jane Goodall Institute in Canada and all the other Jane Goodall Institutes around the world. But in particular, I want to thank my family, and most especially my mother. We can't choose our parents, as I don't suppose we can, and I got lucky. My father I hardly knew because I was only 5 when World War II broke out and he immediately joined the army. But my mother was just this incredible supportive person. And I like to talk about her because being a mother is a very important role. And I know that it was because of the way my mother supported my childhood love of animals, supported the choices I made as I grew older, helped me to be who I am. For example, when I was 1.5 years old, and I don't remember this, but she's told me, she came up to my room and found I'd taken a whole handful of wriggling earthworms, and obviously earth as well, and they were all in my bed. She said, "Jane, you were looking so intently, it was as though you were wondering, how do they walk without legs?" And instead of being angry, you know, how dare you bring all this dirt into your bed, she just said, "Jane, they need the earth, they need the garden. If you leave them here, they'll die." And so we took them back into the garden. And then another story that I know some of you have heard, but I tell it again for a reason. And we lived in London when I was 4.5. Not so many animals living there for an animal-loving little girl. And so it was very exciting when Mum took me for a holiday into the country and onto a farm. In those days, farms were real farms, and animals wandered around in the fields grazing the grass. There were none of these terribly cruel, awful, intensive factory farms that we have today. So I so well remember meeting face to face cows, pigs, horses, and I was given a job to collect the hen's eggs. And the hens were pecking around in the farmyard, but there were about, I don't know, 6 or 8 hen houses. I don't know how big they were, because when you think back to when you were a child, you get the sizes wrong, but anyway, probably about this time. And there the hens slept at night to keep them safe from foxes, and around the edge were the little nest boxes. So a hen would go into the hen house, go into the nest box, and there was a lid which could open from the outside, and my job was to go around each day with my little basket and gather up any eggs that had been laid. So apparently, I began asking everybody, but where is the hole on the head big enough for the egg to come out? I couldn't see one. And obviously, nobody told me, to my satisfaction. What I do remember is seeing this hen. She was brown, and she was going into a hen house, and I must have thought, she's going to lay an egg. I'll find out for myself. And crawling in after her. And I still remember the squawks of fear. She flew back past me, startling me too. And I must have thought, well, no hen will lay an egg here. This is a frightening place. So I went into an empty hen house, and I was gone for over 4 hours. That's a long time for a little girl of four to wait very still and very quiet in a stuffy hen house. But my patience was rewarded. A hen came in, and I can still close my eyes and see that hen slightly rise up and scramble around and make a little sort of nest, and this egg pop out down into the straw. I don't know who was more pleased, me or So by this time it was beginning to get evening. The family had no idea where I was. They even called the police. And you can imagine how frightened my mother must have been. Her little precious Jane disappeared. Where was she? And yet when she saw me running towards the house, instead of doing as so many mothers would, how dare you go out without telling us, don't you dare do it again, which would have killed all the excitement, she saw my shining eyes and sat down to hear the wonderful story of how a hen lays an egg. And isn't that the making of a little scientist? Curiosity, asking questions, not getting the right answer, deciding to find out for yourself, making a mistake, not giving up, and learning patience. And a different kind of mother might have crushed that scientific curiosity, and I might not be standing here as I am tonight. Mm-hmm. She helped in other ways. She found books for me about animals, thinking I would learn to read more quickly. I'm sure she was right. I was 8 years old when I discovered Dr. Doolittle. And anybody who hasn't read the Dr. Doolittle books, please do, because they are absolutely amazing. And when I was growing up, which some young people today find impossible to believe, there was no television. We had the radio, we could listen to people, we could read books. So books were very important for me. And as I've said, we had very little money. And so books mostly came from the library. My Dr. Doolittle books came from the library. The very first book I ever owned all for myself was from my grandmother, and it was the story of Dr. Doolittle. I still have that book.